There is a typo in the tutorial, sorry. It's not minus minus recursive, it's minus minus recurse. So there is, okay, I'm sorry. It's just because, okay, minus minus recursive is an option for something else. Okay. So for working, so you have in the virtual machine, you have all the development tools already set up. So the tool chain, you have a write for recent compiler. You also have all the command line interface tools that allows you to interact with IoT Lab Testbed. So this we will use. You will use only one or two commands at the beginning, and after that, it will be everything is mapped in the build system of Riot nicely with something you. Everything is explained, and in the VM, so there are small editors. So I don't know which one you prefer, Vim or Emacs. So, but for people who are not very easy with those two. You also have, I don't think there is a Visual Studio Code, but you have gedit and other ones. So some word about the IoT Lab Testbed. If you don't know it already, so it's a large-scale experimentation testbed where you can test wireless communication protocols on small devices. So this is the hardware that we provide. Here it's the open node, so it's the part that you can program remotely. We have this one, which is a microcontroller based. This is another setup with embedded Linux, so where you can SSH directly to this device. And this is an old version of the MSP 430. And we have 6 sites in France. And I'm the guy in charge of the Saclay site in the south of France. The biggest site is in Grenoble. Yeah, so we have almost 600 programmable devices. In Saclay, you have a little more than 200. So, and in total, it's around 2,000 something. So we provide a little more than 2,000 programmable devices with several architectures. So Cortex-M from M0, M3, M4, MSP430. You also have the embedded Linux with Cortex-A8, and some provide the AVR with Zigbee board. So heterogeneous platform from different vendors. The IoT Lab M3 or the legacy testbed devices that were designed especially for the testbed, but we are now providing custom devices from the market. So Summer 21 Explain Pro, the reference platform for Riot, for example, but also Arduino Zero with an XB shield, the famous STM32 LoRa board, this one. Zolarcia, Firefly, also some Nordic boards, NRF52, NRF51, NRF52840. We are starting to work on the integration of the PyCom devices, so running the MicroPython firmware and there are other things. So we, thanks to all these heterogeneous platforms, we provide heterogeneous radio, so 15.4, 15.4.g, LoRa, BLE, there are also Wi-Fi, and that's it. And we are working on, so we are planning to integrate NB-IoT devices in the near future. Okay, so the principle of IoT Lab, these are the devices hosted in the platform, connected to an administration embedded Linux. On each site, you have a server that is managing all these devices, and the server itself is connected to the IoT Lab main site. Okay, so you, as a user, you can either connect to the testbed via the web, and you can also control everything on your device from the web interface. But you can also directly SSH to each server site, okay, each server on one of the server on each site, to control your device. Okay, so the principle is, and that this is what we will do this morning. You SSH to this server, you submit your experiment from your computer, so it goes through the HTTP REST interface, and then from your computer via your SSH connection, you can read the serial port via TCP socket. Okay, so everything is done using a command line interface tool. It's totally transparent for you. All the complexity is managed by the testbed. And we offer a lot of tutorials for almost everything. And there is, for example, there is one tutorial to show you how to use the LoRaWAN, the Things Network backend. Okay. So this is the second step that you have to do manually. You will start the VM, and I will give you some papers with an account for the tutorial on IoT Lab. And after that, you need to register the IoT Lab credentials that are on the paper in the VM. This will allow you to run the different command line interface tool to start an experiment with one device, and after that to verify the experiment is started. Okay, so you will have to type this command, just this command, and this command. Okay, so you see the experiment running here. Just started, and they will take 5 hours. Okay, and here is the full list of LoRa boards available in Saclay. So there are 25. Okay, so let's continue. Now, this was the small introduction to set up everything. Now you can go to the getting started instructions and follow the exercises, and it will work normally. So getting started, I think I have something to say here. Okay, so the prerequisites, you don't have to follow them because it's just setting up the VM, so what you already did. And you can just move to the next slide. So the principle, I will just give you a few words of what is a Riot application for those of you who never write a Riot application. A Riot application, you have two files, a make file that describes your application, the default target, the location of the Riot base directory, and then include all the build system instructions to compile the application. That's just the minimal make file for a Riot application. After that, you just write C file, really, standard C file. So, for example, here, this application just include the stdio primitives. You have your main function, and you print something to the standard output. So, on native, it goes directly into your terminal. On the board, it goes through the serial UART connection. So, for example, on this board, the STDIO is printed via the USB port, virtual COM port. Okay, so this is the very minimal application. So, after you want to build your application. The build system of Riot is only using make files, so this means that we use the make build tool to compile, to generate the firmware, which is very standard. You can use it in two ways. First, you go to your application directory and you call make. Make will look into the local directory. Ah, there is a make file. I process this make file to generate the firmware. That's it. Make also has this minus capital C option where you can give it the directory where you have to look for the make file. This is very useful because in Riot, for example, you have a lot of application directories and you don't want to change directory for each application, so you can call make from a single location using this. So I personally find it very useful and I use it all the time, but I know some other people do this, so it's up to you. Okay. Yes. So just one word about the board. So here you have this variable board. Board, it tells the build system, okay, I want to build my firmware for this target. And then the build system will choose the right tool chain for the target. We'll check, okay, it's this architecture, so ARM or x86, AVR. So I need this tool chain, I need the GNU embedded ARM tool chain, I need MIPS, or I need RISC-V or something. Or I just need plain GCC. And it will choose the right compiler. You see there is this question mark equal affectation, which means if the board variable is already defined from the environment, then I use the one already defined. But if there is nothing defined, the default will be native. Okay, so this means that you can overwrite this value from the call to the make command. So here, you call make board equal the new target with the application directory. So it will build your firmware for this target. If you want to know the list of available targets in Riot, just check the directory in the board directory. This corresponds to the name of the target. Okay. And you can also define the Riot base variable to specify another Riot source directory. So I don't know a lot of people doing that, but you can have different copy of Riot, and you can build your application based on different copy of Riot. So in general, I use the default one. Okay. Then you have to run your application. There are two cases. First one is running on native. Native means you build Riot as a Linux process on your computer. So you can directly execute the application from your computer, and it runs Riot in this context. The second is how to run on hardware. So there is a preliminary step before running the application, you have to write your firmware on the flash memory of the board. And then the microcontroller will start the application from there. Okay. So to do that, you use the flash target of make that will call the adapted tool to flash on the board. Okay. So on this board, we have an ST-Link programmer. So you can flash the board using OpenOCD. So it's an external tool. And OpenOCD will take the firmware, copy it on the flash, and start the microcontroller, and then the application is executed automatically. So the build system of Riot handles this automatically for you. You have nothing to change, it's automatic. But it's also configurable if you want. So flash will build and write the firmware on the microcontroller flash memory, and term will open a terminal client connected to the serial port, so you have access to the standard input-output of the application via the serial terminal. You can do this all in one command, make board equal my target, the application directory, flash term, and that's it. So this command can also be used on native for compatibility. But in fact, the flash just call directly the process in this case. Is it okay for everyone? Okay, so now, if you have not done this already, let's build and run your first application, your first Riot application. You can just follow this README. So here is the output of the make command. You have some message telling you, okay, I'm building this application for this platform with this microcontroller. So here it's native, so it's not very useful, but on the board it's different. And you see all the modules that are built in the firmware. And at the end, you get the generated firmware, and you have information on the size of the firmware. Memory, RAM, and ROM size. So make flash term is supposed to be used when the board is effectively plugged on your computer. So it will look at the virtual port available. It's done automatically. Say, oh, okay, it's on /dev/tty/acm0. Okay, I know that I connect to this. But in your case, you cannot use this basic command here because you don't have the board plugged on your computer. So with IoT Lab, there is a special trick to tell the build system that, oh, you are using an IoT Lab node. Okay, you will have to use the IoT Lab CLI tool. So instead of calling OpenOCD to flash the board, it will use the command line interface of IoT Lab to say, okay, send this to IoT Lab, and then and to open the terminal, you do SSH tunnel with a call to a clever tool like called SOAK. You see? It's a little bit more complicated, but within the build system of Riot, this is wrapped nicely. That's all that you... There is a web dev, or you have a command line interface tool. So you post a request to a server that will check the availability of all the devices. And from what you are requesting, it will, so if they are already available, you get your experiment start immediately. Exactly, that's the purpose of this platform, yes. Yes, but here we use IoT Lab because it's very handy for a tutorial. We don't have to provide hardware for everyone. You have yeah, of course. So you can book the node for several hours. You can also book for several days if you don't book the whole site. Having the hardware is nice to test locally on one, but when you want to scale, that's it. Yes. I think I was talking about four different architectures, so between ARM and everything. So we have 25 of these. We have STM32L4, SAMD21, the NRF5251. There is MSP430, but the support is not very good. It's a bit outdated. And we have CC2538. Yeah, 16 different. You can have on the website. There is a list of hardware. And we are extending the list regularly. So if you see the README, the trick to flash on IoT Lab is explained here. So it's explained here. When you call the make flash term command, you tell the build system, okay, I'm using an IoT Lab node. And the build system will automatically call the right tool. My. What? Ah. Attends, j'ai pas compris.
C'est pour la photo.
Ah, ok. Smile, ok. Yes. Okay, so you build a very simple application for Riot, just printing something on the terminal. Now you want to extend it. You want to use the nice feature of Riot. How can you extend your application? There are three ways. You can either use the use module variable, saying, okay, I want to build in my firmware this module. Then in your code, you can use the API and the functions defined by this module. There are a lot of modules. I won't give you all of them here, but I can just give you a few examples. The XTimer. So the XTimer is the old version of timer of Riot, powerful timer with a lot of features, but that has the drawback of using some hardware timer that doesn't support low power mode. So you can't really use it with low power. That's the purpose of the timer discussion of this afternoon. So if you want to attend this breakout session this afternoon, that will be discussed. Okay. There is also the FMT, so it's just a string formatting module, very constrained. If you want to convert an unsigned int to a string or something like or things like this. The shell module is very useful. You will use it during these exercises. Otherwise, you also have access to external packages using the use package variable. So when you call the use package variable, the build system automatically clone a repository from an external project, patch it to make it compatible with Riot, and include it on the fly to your firmware. That's really useful to not have to copy that code that is not written by the Riot community. This is what is used to support the LoRaWAN stack in Riot, for example. So on the second part of the tutorial this morning, you will use the use package variable to clone the LoRaMac node project to have the implementation of the LoRaWAN stack. You can also include microcontroller peripheral drivers using the features required variable. So if you want to use the SPI, the I2C, or UART API directly, you just ensure that the features required are already included in your application. And there is also a mechanism of dependency resolution. So some modules depend on features, or features require a module. So the build system can automatically resolve the dependencies for you, or tell you that you are missing something in your build. Okay, how to use it in your makefile? So here you just do plus equal to extend the content of the use module, the use package, and the features required variables, because these variables contain list of modules, list of package, list of features. Or you can also directly call it from the command line. So you initialize the use module with something, and then you build. Yes. Here? Yes. Yeah, because if you do after, that's why it's... Yeah. Otherwise, it doesn't work. Otherwise, it overloads. Yeah. Okay, so now you will write a simple application with a shell. So you will use the shell module. You will implement callbacks assigned to a shell command, and then it will perform some simple action. And at the end of the getting started, we'll do a small break. And then we'll switch. After that, we'll do the LoRaWAN part, okay? So you all wrote a shell command with Riot? Yes? So we can move to the next exercise. But before, I just want like to tell you how to integrate hardware support to your application. You have several three levels. First, you have the board level, where each board defines some macros for LEDs, buttons, or other stuff. Just to use those macros, you just need to include board.h in your application, and you can access them. There is the CPU level, where we define the peripheral driver APIs for GPIO, I2C, UART. So this is the hardware abstraction layer of Riot. I already told this for about the features required variable earlier. And the third level is the high-level drivers. So when you want to interact with a sensor, with an actuator, with a screen, with a radio. So these are examples of modules that give access to these high-level drivers. So BMP 180, HTS 221, you will use it. And the SX 1276, which is the LoRa radio module that is on this board. So you just need to use module one of these. The system will automatically pull in the I2C feature, the X timer, I think that it's needed, and on some other things, but that's done automatically for you. So you just have to include one line and it's done automatically. So this is the last exercise of the getting started. You can skip the LED exercise. Because of course you are interacting with the board that is in France, you can't see the LED blinking. So there is no... Yes. So there is support for webcam in IoT Lab, but it's not deployed yet for other problems of money, because you need to buy a lot of webcams. And okay, so you can just go to the sensor exercise readme to read the sensor values of the shield plugged on the board. So you just do a temperature shell command that will print the temperature. That's it. Okay. You did it already, or everybody? Okay. And after that, we'll do a coffee break. Have a coffee break.
So now we're gonna keep going with the tutorial and we're gonna get into the LoRaWAN part. So in the repo, we're gonna go to the, so this is the start of the repo, go down, content of the course, and we go to LoRaWAN with Riot. Okay. So there are many IoT protocols, right? And for different applications. The different application at the end will be a combination of power restrictions, data rate restrictions, and range you will want, right? So you have the wireless personal IR network, which you can find Zigbee, Bluetooth, Thread, etc., up and all the way to wireless wide area network, where you have cellular stuff, and also for like for ultra low, for low power application, you have the low power one network technologies like Sigfox, LoRa, Tensar, PTC, etc. And we are gonna get, so we're gonna be in that area of the IoT spectrum. So long range, very low power, and usually not that big data rates. So we're gonna have a quick overview of LoRaWAN. There's a newer specification of LoRaWAN 1.1, but here we're sticking with 1.0. You can work with 1.0, you can still interact with 1.1 gateways, but the registration has changed a little bit, but here we're just gonna be talking about how 1.0 is working. So generic, the file layer is LoRa, which is a proprietary technology. Not like LoRaWAN, which is the MAC layer, and it's driven by the LoRa Alliance, but it's not proprietary. It's gonna be a star network topology, so one gateway that talks individually to many devices. It can be in both ways, uplink and downlink. And just to have a generic idea about how LoRa works, it's a long range technology based on the chip spread spectrum. Chips is just like a signal that's varying in frequency that goes up, 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 and then wraps around when it reaches the end of its frequency band. It has some really nice property, like is very resistant to noise, to multipath interference. You know, when there's a signal that goes from A to B, it's gonna bounce a lot, and there are gonna be other signals and copies of the signals and time shifts of that signal that get to the same point, but you want to detect only the signal, the main signal, and not all those copies and have the interference. So you need to be pretty resistant to that. And yeah, and that's the basic like generic stuff. It's a wireless network, wireless technology, and you have three basic tuning parameters when you're working with LoRa. So you have the power at which you're transmitting, the spreading factor you're gonna be using, and the bandwidth. So the bandwidth is basically how much of the spectrum you're using for one transmission. The spreading factor has to do with, in the same bandwidth or in the same symbol, how many bits of information are you putting into that. So it's kind of an analogy of, if I want to transmit data to you, I can speak really fast, but I'm gonna convey a lot of information to you, but if you're further away, you're gonna have more trouble listening to me, so I'm gonna speak slower and clearer. So that's the idea behind the spreading factor. You put less symbols and less data in the same amount of frequency, so the receiver can hear it clearer, and so when you go up in the spreading factor, you can reach further away, but you're gonna have less data transmitted because you're spreading your information more. So if you look at the small graph, basically, if you have to reach further, you have to have lower data rates, which mean bigger spreading factors, and lowering the bandwidth, because when you have a higher bandwidth, it means you can put more information in the same transmission, but at the same time, higher bandwidth comes with higher decay in the signal, so that means noise is gonna get more important with regard to the signal faster. So as you go, so you only closer to you, you're gonna be able to understand the information you're sending. So just a basic overview. This is more the physical stuff that's happening, but we're gonna be working on top of that. So talking about LoRa Mac, it's a Mac layer that uses the LoRa modulation underneath. There's a bunch of frequency bands that are specified differently for different regions, for Europe, United States, Asia, etc. And we're going to have three main device classes. So here's going to be the file layer, right, the Mac layer, and then you're going to have your application. Then what we're going to do here is the reading sensors and transmitting the data on top of that. Here we can see the different frequency bands that we have. So the frequency bands for Europe is going to be 868 megahertz, 915 is for the US, and in each frequency bands you have different channels where you can transmit, and every channel can have the three different bandwidth which I was talking before. I mean this lower bandwidth you can reach further but less data, bigger bandwidth you can transmit more data but lower distance. Because when you transmit you're also transmitting, everyone is using the same spectrum and transmitting over the air. Here the LoRa Alliance and the specification restricts how much you can transmit, because if I'm transmitting all the time messages, every second a message, I'm completely using the spectrum of at least one channel, and anyone else that wants to transmit is not going to be able to, or if you transmit, we're going to be interfering each other, and no data is going to come across. So there's some restrictions for how often you can transmit, and the physical layer restricts 1% duty cycle. That means that you can only be transmitting for 1% of the time. So if it's in an hour, you can only be transmitting 36 seconds of that whole hour, 1%. But that's a restriction of the physical layer, and the Mac layer itself can have higher restrictions. So there's some cases where that comes more to network operators, and network operators can say we restrict to 0.1% or lower, or just the 1%. And here you can see the example of EU 868 band and some of the channels that you have. Yeah. So this restriction of how often you can transmit has also to do with the time on air of the transmission. How long, once you transmit, your message is going to be hanging in the air and interfering with others. And the time on air at the end is what determines your duty cycle. So you don't have the same time on air for every bandwidth or spreading factor, and that changes. So for example, when you use lower data rates, you can transmit much less often than when you're using higher data rates, because your time on air is much more reduced and the duty cycling is more permissive. It's the same 1%, but it's not 1% about how many transmissions you can do. It's about how much time on air your messages can have. And here are some tools where you can calculate the airtime of a LoRa message according to a spreading factor, quantity of bytes, etc. So I said there were three classes for devices. Here we're just going to be talking about two, but there's a Class A device that can basically, is a device that's going to be most of the time asleep and not, or the radio is not going to be receiving, and every amount of time it's going to send a message, and after sending a message it's going to open a couple of receiving windows where the network could interact with it and tell him. But you have to do it right after it received a message, because afterwards the device is probably going to be going to sleep again and not hearing anything. So it's going to be the most optimal configuration for low power, because most of the time it's asleep and it is not listening, and the act of being listening to for the radios, you're consuming a lot of power, which you can see actually in this graph. So here's basically microcontroller is at sleep. It wakes up, transmits, then it's still up, and it opens two receiving windows, those two pulses there. And then at the end of the receiving time, it goes back to sleep. And that period could be, like, I don't know, here's like half of the time, probably like 5 seconds on, 5 seconds in sleep. But you could be like transmitting once every hour, once a day, and you will have this pulse followed by a lot of flat time. And then you have the Class C device that is always listening, except once it wants to transmit, but it's always hearing and waiting for incoming packets. But that means, like, this graph would always be like this, going up, and then it would be constantly, this would never go down, it would be a constant receiving window all the way. And this is like the basic structure of LoRaWAN architecture. You're gonna have different end nodes, applications that can be a wireless meteorological station deployed somewhere. They're gonna be LoRaWAN gateways somewhere in the range of that node that can go up to 10 kilometers when there's line of sight, so it's pretty far away. And then that gets conveyed to a network server, which goes to the application server. And up to here is actually the LoRaWAN part, because here are still there's some handling of how the session access keys are handled, which I'm going to explain a little bit more afterwards. But after this is regular internet encryption, handling, connection, etc. So and security of the data is guaranteed with IS encryption. That means the encryption from here to here. Then it can, how it goes, this part, it can be different. It's up to the implementation. This is a small overview of the stack. So here we have what would be a device. It has the sensor or file layer that's communicating with the other file layer in the gateway. And then you have the device is probably speaking through SPI with the microcontroller that has a hardware abstraction layer, the LoRaWAN code, and finally the customer application that's going to be, for example, reading the sensor, preparing the packet, passing it to the LoRaWAN stack that's going to prepare the MAC frame, and then send it to the file layer that's going to actually send the radio pulses that the gateway is going to decode. And whether this part is encrypted, it's up to the application. This is always going to be encrypted on the LoRa, the MAC layer encryption, but you can also add encryption, application level encryption. So because if not, it's going to be, if we go back, it will only be encrypted from here to here, but not from here to here. If you want to end-to-end encryption, you have to take over of the application part. And there's a couple of libraries implementing this LoRaMax stack. One of them is LoRaMax in C. There's LoRaMax Node, which is the reference implementation by Semtech. We have someone in the community that's working on its own implementation of the LoRaMax stack. And then you have a bunch of OS that implement or use this. Usually, most of these are making a port or using this library, which is the Semtech reference implementations, which we do as well. It's the one we support for right now, and it's the one we're going to be using for this tutorial. And so this is just a little overview of how device registration and encryption works. So when a device will have a bunch of identifiers, it has a device address, a network session key, and application session key. You can see network session key to encrypt the network related stuff, and the application session key to encrypt the application data. But this is once a device is already registered with a network. At first, depending on how you register, I don't know if there's a slide talking about that. Yeah, okay. So this is the basic stuff. Basically, the network session key is used to encrypt all the MAC stuff, and the application session key to encrypt all the application stuff. And there's two ways to join a network, ABP, activation by parameterization, and OTA. What ABP basically takes over from already this state where you already have a device address, network session key, and you don't have to register, you just start transmitting to your network server. But the network server has to already know that I have this device that has this session keys and application key, I recognize it, and I'll accept, and I'm able to decode what he's sending. If it's not registered, whatever you send is going to be gibberish that's not going to be able to understand, and or it's not going to accept it. So the other option is to have activation over the air activation where the device has a unique device identifier, an application key, and an application unique identifier. And it goes through a process where when it turns on, it first sends a message to network server where it's a basically a handshake operation where it say, hey, I'm here, I want to start transmitting. The network server is going to look into its registered device, and if this dev UE belongs to its registered device, and the application key and the API UE is right, it's going to, over a handshake operation, it's going to send them the network session key, the application session key, and the device address for that device. But every time you're rebooting, and if you don't save those data, you're going to have to go again through the handshake procedure. Yeah. So basically what I said here, in ABP, no handshake is required. Here you do have to go through that handshake. So if we look at again at the initial graph, we have network operators. Some of them are of the public network. You have Activity, LoRiot. Some of the network operators. Here in the tutorial, we're going to be working with the Things network. If you go to the Things network, you can have a map of publicly available gateways. So, yeah. Here? Or? Yeah. Yes, it's incredible because you have these application session keys and which are used to encrypt this first message that is a device AUE, unique identifier, and the application unique identifier, plus a generated from the app key, and that the server knows that has the matching key to decrypt that, and it will send afterwards another encrypted message with the device address, application nonce, and other stuff. And with that application nonce, then the device will generate their application session keys and network session keys locally. So the only thing that's actually assigned by the network is the device address and a nonce with which it will generate the session keys for the continuous communication. And so what's nice about this is you can for free create an account, use gateways that are in the network. There's no device limit, no message limit when you respect the duty cycle, and there's a bunch of API, useful API stuff like MQTT, etc. And so what are you going to do here is like you're just going to create an account in the Things network, but you don't own a gateway. I don't own a gateway. We're just going to be using gateways that are already deployed and available in the Things network. Any questions so far? Are we good? Yeah. So now we're going to get to the first step. So as I said, we're going to create a Things network account. So you can go here and follow the steps to create an account. Then we're going to add a new application. And you have to register your device in our application. So, yeah. So if you go, you're going to see that when you create an account, add an application, and add a device, you can either specify a device identifier and applications keys, or it will generate automatically generate them automatically for you, and then we'll use those. We're good here? Yeah. Okay, so let's get to creating the account and doing this setup.
So just one checkpoint. How many of you have reached this point? Okay, you're before. So you can send sensor data to the backend. Okay, you have done the sensor part of the LoRaWAN just before. This exercise, you are here. Okay. Yeah, that's great. But if you can send some text, you can send everything. Yes, there is a nice MQTT API, so you can script the message that you receive and do something with it. Yeah. So after that, you have credentials. You can connect and so in this tutorial at the very end, there is a Python script provided that shows how to connect to the MQTT broker and receive the data locally. So just a few words on the if you want to receive the data on the dashboard, there is a consensus to find between the device and between the backend. You need to encode the data in a certain format. Okay, the device encodes the payload in a given format, the smallest possible, and then the backend is able, the application, the dashboard application, has some code to decode this payload and then to extract the information from it. And this format is called low power payload LPP. When you use the Cayenne on my devices, Cayenne application on my devices. So the idea is to use an external library, and we will use this one, the library in C that I wrote last year. It's inspired from the embed version, which is available as a package in Riot. So it's a super simple API that will allow you to encode the payload in my device's compliant format. And there is this example. At the end of this exercise, you will normally get your data on the web dashboard using LoRaWAN, okay? And this is the last line. And the first one who succeeds will get a board for free. Yeah, but you are cheating, I know.